At 10 p.m. on November the 14th last year, a squad of Fulchester policemen arrived at Gander Common to evict a group of gypsies who'd been illegally squatting there. The police officer in charge was Inspector Macbeth. The gypsies refused to obey the police instructions, and during the course of the ensuing scuffle, Councillor Knox sustained severe injuries. Now, Reuben Hartley, a member of this squatting gypsy community, stands trial in Fulchester Crown Court, charged with causing Councillor Knox grievous bodily harm. Mr. Justice Campbell presides in the case of the Queen against Hartley.
This sketch plan shows, to the best of your recollection, the positions of the various people involved in this incident. Does it, Inspector?
Yes, madam.
It was at approximately 10 p.m. on Friday, November the 14th of last year, that you say you arrived on Gander Common with a squad of policemen. Now, what you haven't yet explained to us is why you undertook this operation.
We were to help remove a group of squatters from the common, madam.
On whose authority were the squatters to be removed?
On the authority of the chairman of Fulchester County Council.
Had eviction notices already been served?
They had.
Now, Chief Inspector Macbeth, would you please tell the court what action the police were empowered to take as a result of the squatters' failure to observe these eviction notices?
We were to tow them off.
Ah, well, would you elaborate on that a little?
We had power to assist the bailiffs to tow away the caravans that the gypos were living in by fixing them to either tractors or land rovers.
Please, Inspector, what do you mean by gypos? I think it is better if we avoid colloquialisms.
Gypsies, my lord.
Romany gypsies?
No, my lord, just gypsies.
Well, that's a derogatory statement, my lord, to which I must object.
Well, I don't see anything derogatory in that.
How is it derogatory?
Oh, my lord, the word gypsy and the tone in which it was expressed are thoroughly prejudicial to my client.
Then what in heaven's name are they to be called?
Travellers, my lord? That's an all-embracing name, and it's a respectful one.
Oh, very well, if it'll prevent anyone being upset.
Thank you, my lord.
Very well, Mrs. Dixon.
How long had these travellers been squatting on Gander Common?
About 10 years, madam.
And all attempts to remove them had failed over a decade?
Well, the authorities and we ourselves had turned a blind eye to it for many years, madam.
Well, my lord, Chief Inspector Macbeth may answer for the police, but not, I think, for Fulchester County Council.
Yes, my next witness will answer for Fulchester County Council.
Yes, indeed, Inspector. You should confine your evidence to the area of your knowledge.
Yes, my lord.
Right, what eventually prompted you to enforce these eviction notices?
I was instructed on the afternoon of the 14th of November in a letter written by the chairman of Fulchester County Council and handed to me by the clerk of Fulchester County Council that as repeated eviction notices had been ignored, we were to help the bailiffs tow away the 6 caravans from the common by attaching them to our own official vehicles.
Which were what?
Land Rovers.
Now tell me, had these 6 been the only caravans parked on Gander Common during this 10-year period?
No, madam, they were the residual. There had originally been about 28 caravans there.
Uh-huh, and what had happened to the other 22?
They had been moved to an officially designated site.
I see.
Just a moment, Mrs. Dixon. Why was this residual, as you call it, left behind?
Because there were only 22 hard standings on the official site, my lord, and 28 caravans.
So where were the other 6 to go?
They were to be removed from Gander Common, my lord.
You haven't answered my question. Where were they to go?
Nowhere! No bloody way! They never goes any bloody way to go!
Silence!
Ulster! You don't know the art of this!
Anyone interrupting will be ejected. Now, do you understand? Very well.
They would have to move over the county boundary, my lord, and try their luck elsewhere.
So there's no room for these travellers in this county.
That's correct, my lord.
I see. Mrs. Dixon.
Yes, my lord.
What is the law governing these officially designated sites?
Where's that one? It's under there. Thank you. In 1968, the Caravan Sites Act Part 2 made it a duty for local authorities to provide sites for gypsies and other travellers residing in or resorting to their area.
And it looks as if the Fulchester County Council have not complied with the Act.
Inspector, would you describe the action you took on arriving at Gander Common?
I asked the travellers if they were prepared to move on.
Did you ask anyone in particular?
I asked them as a group.
And was there any reply?
I was told to piss off.
And?
I asked them again.
And what happened?
They replied in a similar vein.
And then what happened?
We then proceeded to hitch our Land Rovers to the tow bars of the caravans.
Yes, where were you going to tow them?
Off the common, my lord.
Yes, yes, but then where?
We would tow them to the next lay-by, my lord, and then ensure that the travellers towed them away.
To the next county?
Yes, my lord.
I see.
What happened whilst you were completing this hitching operation?
They tried to take the wheels off the caravans by trying to jack them up.
Yes, but when did the scuffling occur?
Well, that was later, when Councillor Knox arrived.
Which was when?
Approximately 10:40. Councillor Knox also tried to make them see reason, but they wouldn't.
Did they respond to him as they had to you?
And worse.
Now, did the travellers' group have a ringleader?
Reuben Hartley.
Yes, could you be a little more specific, Inspector? What did he do which made you believe that he was the ringleader?
He was the noisiest, my lord.
I see.
What is the last thing you recall before the violence broke out?
That would be when Councillor Knox offered the accused and his family temporary accommodation in his own home.
How had he come to make this offer?
Hartley's caravan had been unavoidably damaged while we were trying to pull it away.
In what way was it damaged?
They'd wrenched a wheel off, my lord. It veered round and hit a tree.
This was before Councillor Knox arrived?
Yes, ma'am.
Right, so Councillor Knox magnanimously offered Hartley and his family accommodation when...
Hartley hit him.
Where?
In the face.
I never hit him! I've got bloody shame! Good up! He's got shame, eh?
And what happened then?
Well, before we could intervene, we were attacked by the remaining travellers. During the course of the scuffle, I saw Councillor Knox pushed to the ground.
By whom?
By Hartley. And before I could get to him, I saw Councillor Knox being kicked.
Who was doing the kicking?
Hartley.
Hartley. And what was your next step?
When we regained control of the situation, I went to Councillor Knox's aid. I called an ambulance. I then cautioned and arrested Hartley.
Did he make a statement?
Later at the police station.
Inspector Macbeth, would you please read the accused statement to the court?
I did not hit Knox, only once. I never kicked him. I'm not guilty. I was away looking for my girl. I hit him once and ran looking for my little girl. She was scared. I found her. I put her in my trailer. Then I was nicked.
And that was written by Hartley?
Dictated by Hartley to a police officer and then signed by Hartley.
Were other arrests made?
Now, the remaining travellers were arrested and charged with assaulting police officers. They were dealt with in the magistrate's court.
Silence!
And you are quite sure, Inspector, are you, that it was the accused, Reuben Hartley, who so savagely attacked Councillor Knox?
Quite sure, madam.
Thank you, Inspector.
Well, I see that Mr. Hartley spent over 16 hours in the police station before he was seen by a solicitor.
Yes, sir.
Why so long?
He wasn't prevented, sir. He didn't ask to see a solicitor.
Yes, but some of the travellers had come to the police station and asked if he wanted them to find a lawyer, a solicitor, isn't that so?
Yes, sir.
And you said that he didn't.
That's correct, sir. He hadn't asked to see a solicitor.
Well, did it not occur to you that he might not be aware of his right to see a solicitor?
I had told him of his right to contact a solicitor, sir.
No, I suggest that you hadn't told him and that he remained entirely ignorant of his right for 16 hours until a solicitor, found by his friends, arrived at the police station.
There are also notices in the police station, sir, advising prisoners of their rights.
But Hartley can't read, can he?
I didn't know that at the time, sir.
How did he make this statement which you read out to us just now?
He dictated it to a constable who wrote it down. He then put his mark on it.
He put his mark on it? So you appreciated then, did you not, that he was illiterate?
Yes, sir.
So why tell us all about notices on the walls of the police station? He couldn't read those, could he?
Because it was only later on that he made the statement, sir.
I see. Well, let's go back, shall we, over the circumstances of this scuffle, Chief
Inspector. If you wish, sir.
The night of November the 14th was, in fact, a moonless night, wasn't it?
I really can't remember, sir.
Ah, well, luckily the meteorological office can. A very dark night. Have any means of illumination?
The headlights of the Land Rovers and torches, sir.
Yes, but according to your sketch here, the attack on Mr. Knox took place behind the Land Rovers. So the headlights wouldn't have illuminated the incident, would they?
There was more than enough light to witness the incident, sir.
Well, I wonder if you'd show us this sketch of yours again. Inspector, hold it up for the benefit of the jury. This, ladies and gentlemen, you will recall, is meant to represent the positions of the alleged combatants. You claim that there were two groups separated by a Land Rover attached to a caravan.
Yes, sir.
How long was it from the outbreak of the scuffle to your discovery of the injured Mr. Knox?
About 90 seconds, sir.
90 seconds. Well, let's run over those 90 seconds, shall we, Inspector? Would you mind giving us your account again?
Well, Councillor Knox had
yes,
been...
Yes, where was he standing?
The other side of the caravan, sir.
To you and your men?
Yes, sir.
Then how could you see them?
Over the tow bars.
You could see everybody?
I could see Councillor Knox, one of his colleagues, and Hartley. The bailiffs had withdrawn to the other side of the woods to their vehicles.
Yes, wait a minute. I don't think you mentioned earlier that Mr. Knox came with his colleagues, did you?
One colleague, sir.
Did you know him?
Mr. Bruton, the Borough Surveyor.
My Lord, Inspector Macbeth has been over all this in his evidence in chief.
Not all of it, Mrs. Dixon. Besides, Mr. Harvesty is quite entitled to ask these questions.
Thank you, my Lord. Now, as you've already stated, Chief Inspector, Mr. Knox made this magnanimous offer of hospitality.
And Hartley hit him in the face.
Then why didn't you immediately go and protect him, Inspector?
Exactly what I would have done, sir, if we'd not been attacked by the other travellers.
You fought them off?
We restrained them, sir.
After you had restrained them, what was your next move?
I then hurried round the Land Rover,
sir. With your torch?
No, sir.
Oh, why not?
Because I had dropped it, sir, when we were...
When restraining?
Yes, sir.
Yes. Yes, so you went to the other side of the Land Rover?
Where I found Councillor Knox lying on the ground. Hartley was some yards away in the door of a caravan, breathing very heavily.
Were there any other travellers around?
No, sir.
Was Mr. Knox conscious?
No, sir.
Where was Mr. Knox's colleague?
A few feet away, sir.
Also unconscious?
Dazed and shocked, sir.
What were the extent of his injuries?
He had a cut over the right eye.
But nothing more?
No, sir. Mm-hmm.
Chief Inspector, I put it to you that on a moonless night and without your torch, it would have been quite impossible for you to make out what was happening.
There was enough light to see exactly what was happening, sir.
Well, you must have eyes like a cat.
It was clear enough to see what was
my
happening.
My Lord, my learned friend is not entitled to make that sort of comment, as he well knows.
He ought to know.
Yes,
Mrs. Dixon.
I'm sorry, my Lord. Chief Inspector, what was your next action?
I arrested Hartley.
Did he resist?
No, sir.
So there was no need to use any further restraint.
I call Councillor Ernest Knox.
Ernest Knox, please. Your religion?
Church of England.
Take the Bible in your right hand and read aloud the words on this card.
I swear by Almighty God that the evidence I shall give shall be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth.
You are Councillor Ernest James Knox, and you live at The Grove, Elm Lane, Fulchester.
Yes.
What is your occupation, Mr. Knox?
I'm in building.
Would you prefer to sit down?
Oh, thank you. I can stand.
May I ask you the extent of your injuries, Mr. Knox? Mr. Knox, would you please answer the question?
Well, I've lost the vision of one eye and I have a punctured lung.
Are either of these two injuries permanent?
They both are.
You mean there's nothing that can be done?
Nothing.
I see. Mr. Knox, you've been a Labour councillor in Fulchester County Council for 15 years.
Yes.
And I see you recently received the MBE. May I ask what that was for?
It was for services rendered to the Ravenscourt Youth Project.
Which is what?
Well, it's a youth project based in the Midlands, geared to assist underprivileged young people in a variety of different ways, in terms of education, social work and so on.
And what is your role?
I'm chairman of the executive committee.
Now, you've also taken a strong interest in travellers.
Yes.
Well, would you tell the court a little about your work?
Well, as you know, a number of travellers were encamped around Fulchester.
Illegally?
Yes, and it was this fact that determined me to campaign for a legally designated site, which should have been set up under the 1968 Act.
Was there resistance to this idea?
I'm afraid so, yes.
But you overcame it?
Yes.
Is it through your campaigning and your campaigning alone that the official site now exists?
Oh, not at all. A number of my colleagues backed the scheme. My chief regret was we couldn't accommodate all travellers.
So you are a councillor. You're chairman of the executive committee of a large charity. You're a campaigner on behalf of and a friend to the travelling community in Fulchester. All this, and I believe you also run your own business.
Well, I enjoy my work.
Now tell me, Mr. Knox, how well did you know Reuben Hartley and his family?
Oh, very well.
You always had a friendly relationship with them?
Until November, yes.
Could you please describe the events leading up to the assault?
It's very simple. There was space for 22 caravans on the site. We had a terrible squeeze getting them all on. In no way could we accommodate another six.
Of which Hartley's caravan was one?
Yes.
Now, how were these spaces allocated?
Literally had to put him in a hat.
The luck of the draw?
Yes.
So, Hartley was a bad loser?
Oh, I wouldn't put it that way.
Would you please tell the court what you can remember about the attack itself?
Well, I discovered that the chairman had ordered the bailiffs to go up to the common and clear the other six caravans off the site. Having made this discovery, I hurried after them.
Taking a colleague?
Oh, yes, I took my colleague, Mr. Bruton, with me.
And what is Mr. Bruton's position?
A borough surveyor.
So you arrived at the site to find what?
That a very ugly situation had developed. I tried to calm Mr. Hartley down. I offered him and his family a night's hospitality in my own home.
And what happened?
Well, I can't remember very well. I remember falling to the ground and then a great deal of pain.
Did no one come to your assistance?
No, well, you see, the police vehicles, well, the police were the other side of their own vehicles, and Mr. Bruton...
Yes, we shall be hearing from Mr. Bruton later, but what I mean is, did none of the other travellers try to help you?
No, it would be very hard. Hartley's very strong. And at this time, he was out of control, hysterical. I don't want to blacken his character. He's a good man.
Yes, you did see who it was that made the attack.
Well, I'm afraid so, my lord. It was Reuben, all right.
One final question, Mr. Knox. How long were you in hospital receiving treatment for your injuries?
3.5 months.
And you still bear no grudge?
You're lying, running bastard! It was the rape of Woody, that's why you wanted us on, you bastard!
That will do, Hartley. I said that will do. Now, one more word out of you and I shall send you down to the cells and continue the case without you.
Weren't you surprised, Mr. Knox, at Mr. Hartley's action?
Oh, no, he was overwrought.
And you bear him no grudge?
Of course not.
Despite your injuries?
Well, as you know, I'm a very unwilling prosecution witness. However, I believe that law and order must be sustained.
Thank you, Mr. Knox.
Mr. Knox, what kind of business do you own?
I'm in building.
That's not very explicit.
Well, I own a building firm of which I am chairman.
Are you in any way a property developer?
No, we're on contract work only.
So you don't own any land?
Well, I own my own house, my own business
premises. No, I meant in addition to that.
No.
No land?
Well, I have occasionally owned land.
Ah, so then you are a property developer.
In that sense of the word, no.
Yes, but surely
my
if you
Lord,
say
how
you've...
How can these questions have any possible relevance to this case?
Mr. Harvester.
My lord, I do assure you these questions are relevant.
Very well.
Thank you, my lord. Mr. Knox, who owns Gander Common?
Well, there's a section owned by the official receiver, there's a section owned by the Fulchester County Council, and there's a section owned by a property company. Needless to say, I have no connection with this.
I see. And on which part were the travellers encamped?
They're owned two sections, one owned by the Fulchester County Council and one owned by Fulchester Town and Country Properties.
Yes. Can you explain why it was necessary for Fulchester County Council to carry out the eviction themselves?
Well, Gander Common, as you may or may not know, is surrounded by a council housing estate. There have been numerous complaints.
Oh, what sort of complaints?
Well, they range from children being frightened going across the common back from school to noise, smell, fire, dogs barking, mess, you name it.
Oh, didn't you do anything to forestall these complaints?
Oh, yes, I had a meeting in a hall on the estate. I had a group of the travellers on the platform discussing the matter with the Residents Association. I couldn't have done much more.
No, it's a most commendable idea. So you can assure the court, can you, Mr. Knox, that the only motivation you had in moving these final squatters was on the grounds of law and order?
That is correct.
And the only motivation you had in appearing here as a prosecution witness was on the grounds of law and order?
That is also correct.
No more questions.
So you have no doubt, Mr. Bruton, that it was Hartley and Hartley alone who attacked Mr. Knox?
No doubt at all, madam.
Would you please tell us all you can recall of these events?
Certainly. The attack was precipitated by Mr. Knox's generous offer of hospitality. Hartley threw himself on Knox, and Mr. Knox fell to the ground. Since the police were otherwise occupied, I rushed forward to assist Mr. Knox. As I did so, I was struck over the eye by a missile.
Thrown by whom?
It was impossible to tell, madam.
Well, did you think it was thrown by Hartley?
My lord.
Yes, indeed. That really will not do, Mrs. Dixon.
Are you quite sure that you didn't see who threw the missile?
Quite sure, ma'am.
Very well. Then what happened?
I passed out. When I regained consciousness, I saw Mr. Knox lying on the ground, surrounded by policemen.
Where was Hartley?
He was not there, madam.
Thank you, Mr. Bruton.
Mr. Bruton, how did you get your trousers back on?
I beg your pardon?
Well, perhaps we should begin at the beginning. I suggest that rather than rushing to aid Mr. Knox, you rushed in quite the opposite direction.
I beg your pardon?
Pursued by two women who are threatening to haul your trousers off.
Nonsense.
I further suggest to you that when you returned, having been pursued in a full circle round the caravans, you tripped and fell and rendered yourself temporarily unconscious.
Rubbish, I tell you.
There are witnesses.
Then they're lying witnesses.
But I further suggest to you, Mr. Bruton, that you never saw my client hit Mr. Knox in the first place.
This is completely untrue.
Do you deny running and being pursued by the women?
I totally deny it.
Then may I ask you what this is?
I've no idea.
Well, that, Mr. Bruton, is the seat of your trousers.
I've never heard such nonsense in my life. This is absolute nonsense. I'm absolutely astonished. Well, it's ridiculous.
My lord, may I introduce this now as an exhibit?
The case of the Queen against Hartley will be resumed tomorrow in the Crown Court. In Fulchester Crown Court, Inspector Macbeth of the Fulchester Police, Councillor Ernest Knox and Derek Bruton of Fulchester County Council are given their version of the events leading up to the attempted eviction of a group of gypsies or travellers from an area known as Gander Common. The accused, Reuben Hartley, is charged with causing grievous bodily harm to Councillor Knox. Defence Counsel has cross-examined Ernest Knox over his financial interest and has accused Derek Bruton, Borough Surveyor of Fulchester County Council, of lying. Now he is examining his first witness, the accused, Reuben Hartley.
So your relationship with Mr. Knox was friendly up until the time that lots were drawn for this new site?
I was friendly with him, I.
Yes, but for how long?
Until he ratted on me. And I saw him for what he was, a right muckster.
Could you make yourself clearer?
Well, he was on to the main chance, wasn't he?
In what way do you consider that Mr. Knox was on to the main chance?
Well, it was him who took it.
I'm sorry, I don't think we understand.
Well, everybody bloody knows.
The court does not. Kindly make yourself clear.
Look, old Knoxy won't be no bloody saint setting up that site, see?
No?
Well, he was up to his tricks, wasn't he?
Your witness really must try to be more explicit and less abusive. Now, do you understand?
No, sir.
You really have to try... Oh, carry on, Mr. Harvester.
Yes, my lord. What kind of tricks are you suggesting that Mr. Knox was up to?
Well, the only reason he was friendly with us folks was this. He fought for that site for his own reasons, not ours. And in the end, he couldn't get us off like he planned. You should have seen his mush when Gavers was trying to get us off.
What on earth are Gavers?
A policeman, my lord.
Quite a linguist, Mr. Harvester.
Oh, you flatter me, my lord.
Carry on.
Lord, what were Mr. Knox's reasons for removing you all, in your view?
He was going to build a frigging petrol garage on the site, wasn't he?
Oh, really, my lord, this is quite intolerable. None of this was put to Mr. Knox in cross-examination.
What do you intend to do about these allegations, Mr. Harvester?
Well, if necessary, Mr. Knox can be recalled, my lord.
Well, let me remind you, and I think I must remind the jury too, that we're not here to discuss the social morality of the private ownership of land. We are here to try a case where the defendant is accused of causing grievous bodily harm to councillor Knox. And that case alone. Now, I hope I make myself clear, Mr. Harvester.
Yes, indeed, my lord. But these matters...
Yes,
are...
yes, quite. But we might as well keep our eye on the main issues.
Oh, it's my constant endeavour, my lord. Mr. Hartley, how long have you been squatting on Gander Common?
About 10 years.
And before that?
I was down at Rushy Green. Well, then were good days. Then we was free. The Gorgios left us alone.
Translate, please.
Gorgios, my lord, that's us. Non-gypsies.
Ah.
What was the reason that you had to move from Rushy Green?
Well, it's taken over by council for allotments.
Yes. You have 8 children, Mr. Hartley?
One of them a runt.
I beg your pardon.
She's a spastic child, my lord.
I see, thank you.
What was life like on Gander Common?
Rough.
You've always had the same job, Mr. Hartley?
Oh, yeah, tinning.
What does that mean?
That means he's a scrap metal merchant, my lord.
I see, thank you.
Could you carry out your job in the same way at Gander Common as you'd been able to do at Rushy Green?
I couldn't, could I?
Why not?
Well, council on the approach road. They won't let stick of motors up there.
I see. What other problems did you face there?
Oh, there's the Gorgios. Oh, we didn't do nothing to them, but they did a lot to us.
What did they do to you?
Well, pelted us.
You mean they stoned your caravans?
Yeah, with firebombs.
Firebombs? Petrol bombs, you mean?
And with babbies sleeping in trailers!
Did you ever catch these people?
Yeah. Kids. We give them a thumping light.
Indeed. What happened then?
Well, Gavers come round, told us to lay off.
But didn't they tell the local residents to lay off?
No.
Did you ask the police for help?
Well, said we weren't entitled because we were squatting law.
Mr. Hartley, I believe that a daughter of yours was killed as an indirect result of one of these incidents.
Sheila, yeah.
Would you tell us what happened?
Well, they come pelting! So you ran across the road. Motorator.
Mr. Hartley, would you have wished to move to the new local authority site?
Look, I'm not a fool. It's always the same. That they say you can take the motors on, and then they say no more motors, just like that. Well, it's our living. So they shove us into local factories. And cheap labour, like. Well, they're always short of men. and they start moving us into their houses. Damp prefabs at the bum end of the estate where the tarts are, gougeos.
Now, Mr. Hartley, you are pleading not guilty to a charge of grievous bodily harm. But did you, at any time on the night of November the 14th of last year, hit Mr. Knox?
Oh, yeah.
How did this happen?
Well, I lost my temper, see. A bleeding hypocrite he was, coming round all mealy-mouthed, offering me his house. I never slept in house in my life.
So what did you do?
Well, I whacked him when he fell over.
Where did you hit him? In the eye?
Oh, no, on the chin.
Yes, and then what?
Well, I went away, didn't I?
Why did you go away?
Well, Liz was calling.
Liz, that's your daughter. That's your spastic daughter.
Well, she was running. Scared of the noise and the fighting. She was running through the woods towards the road. So I went after her and I brought her back, sobbing, to the trailer. Then I was nicked just as I was walking away from the trailer, like.
You at no time returned to Mr. Knox?
Oh, no, I was nicked before I could.
And so you never at any point kicked Mr. Knox in the face, in the chest, or in the stomach?
Look, Mosh, how could
thank
I when
you,
I was...
Thank you, no further questions.
You are accused of inflicting grievous bodily harm on Mr. Knox. He is left with terrible and permanent injuries. I understand you now admit assaulting him.
On either once.
And then again later.
No, I went after me girl.
Two witnesses have said that you did not, Mr. Knox and Chief Inspector Macbeth.
Well, that bleeding cobber could say nothing!
Please refrain from using that sort of language.
Aye?
Don't swear.
You say you chased after your daughter, you caught her, and brought her sobbing back to your caravan. You went inside...
And I was nicked as I come out.
Quite. Now, my point is that all this took far longer than the very short time of 90 seconds when Inspector Macbeth had his eyes off you. I suggest that you not only hit Mr. Knox and forced him to the ground...
No.
But you remained there and you kicked him repeatedly.
You're a bloody liar!
That will do.
She's lying! The
officer,
bloody women don't say anything!
Mrs. Robinson, did you and your friend Mrs. Street have something to do with the ripping of that piece of cloth from somebody's trousers?
I never touched him.
I beg your pardon?
Oh, we never touched him.
Mrs. Robinson, you agreed to come here as a defence witness.
As a what?
You know very well what I mean.
Here, don't you speak to me like that.
I will ask you the question again,
Mrs. Robinson. Tell the gentleman what he wants to know. You
Hartley.
What does he want?
Hartley, I have already told you that we are entitled to hear your case in your absence. Now, Mr. Harvester, you really must not harass your own witness.
I'd like to treat her as a hostile witness, my lord.
Yes, well, I'm afraid you can't, Mr. Hartley. Mr. Harvester, she has not said anything, let alone anything detrimental to your case. Now, Mrs. Robinson, do you understand that you were called here today to give evidence in Hartley's defence?
I don't understand nothing.
What do you mean to say that you do not understand why you were called here
no.
today?
No!
Well, she may as well go, I suppose, my lord.
Oh, right.
Oh, my lord, I would like to ask her some questions, if I may. She's been sworn in and she's in the witness box.
Very well.
Mrs. Robinson... Is the reason you're refusing to give evidence for the accused because that evidence that you were going to give is false?
Hey.
You have decided, have you, to tell the truth instead?
That's it.
Now, did somebody originally try to make you tell lies?
My lord, these questions
yes,
are quite
well.
Improperly phrased.
I do apologise, my lord. Mrs. Robinson, how long have you known Mr. Hartley?
All my life.
And what do you think of him?
Oh, he's a right troublemaker.
In what way?
He's never satisfied.
With what?
Well, with All that Mr. Knox tried to do for him, like, helping him with his family and all.
How exactly did Mr. Knox help him with his family?
Oh, well, he was going to help with Lizzie.
Oh, that's his spastic daughter?
He was going to send her to a special school. To help her, like.
And how did Mr. Hartley react to that?
Oh, he didn't want to know, not him.
Why not?
But what do you want to ask her?
Too proud, he said. Too bloody minded, I say. Now, look here. He stood in the way of his own daughter getting help. That's not right. And he beat my Herbie half to death.
Mrs. Robinson, just calm down. Now, who is Herbie?
My son, only 15. Rube said he caught him licking out of the trailer, and he beat him half to death, the poor little sod.
Did you go to the police?
No.
Now, members of the jury, it is plain that this is a completely unsubstantiated allegation to which we must pay no attention.
Mrs. Robinson, did you see what went on?
Some of it.
Mm-hmm. And where were you at the time?
In my trailer, out of harm's way.
And could you see both sides of the combat from your trailer?
Well, I could see the gathers. And I could see Mr. Knox and Mr. Booten.
And what happened?
Mr. Knox said something to Reuben, and he bashed him and he knocked him on the ground.
And what happened to Mr. Booten?
Well, when he bashed Mr. Knox, he picked up a stone and he threw it at Mr. Booten and he fell on the ground and all.
Now, Mrs. Robinson, do you understand that you are under oath?
Yes.
And do you understand that there are very serious penalties for lying under oath?
But I'm telling the truth, so help me God.
I don't understand why you appear as a defence witness and then at the last moment turn into a prosecution witness.
Oh, I don't understand a word you say.
Mr. Harvesty thought that you were coming here to defend Mr. Hartley, not to accuse him.
Oh, yes, well, it's like this, you see. I felt sorry for him at the time, and I thought I'd try and get him off.
By lying under oath?
Yes, well, I thought better of it, didn't I?
Did you?
Look, mister, I thought better of it. I decided to tell the truth, right?
At the last moment.
That's it!
Right.
Mrs. Robinson, after you saw Mr. Bruton fall to the ground as a result of the missile thrown at him by the accused, what happened then?
Oh, well, then it was well nigh bleeding murder, wasn't it? He was still on the ground and Reuben started kicking him. Kicked his bleeding head in, he did. There was blood everywhere. And him, he just went on laughing. He was laughing his bloody head off.
Mr. Kimmins, you're a qualified social worker employed by the Social Service Department of Fulchester County Council.
That's correct.
How long have you been associated with travellers?
About 10 years, ever since I graduated.
I see. Tell me, Mr. Kimmins, how do you see the plight of the travelling people?
Well, I'm afraid it couldn't be much worse. I don't think it would be an exaggeration to say that the travellers in our present civilised society hold a similar position to the lepers of the past. Go to any gypsy encampment. Have a look at the notices in the surrounding shop and pub windows. Troublesome van dwellers not welcome. Gippos keep out. And yet these are the very same people who in the past were craftsmen and dealers and could supplement this with casual farm work. Mm. Well, mechanisation has put a stop to all that, and now the only trade they've got is scrap metalling. Also, of course, every single one of their traditional campsites has been swallowed up by urban development. So we now have a situation where we're living in a country with one of the most advanced social services in the world, and yet we have an entire community that has no place where it can legally live. Oh, yes, I know there are the official sites.
Yeah.
But those are few and far between and quite disgustingly inadequate, despite the responsibility imposed on the local authorities by the government. So now, of course, the gypsies have to camp wherever they can find an open space, which, of course, is illegal. But then they have no alternative.
My lord, my learned friend seems to be trying to turn this court into a platform for the civil liberties of travellers.
Yes, indeed, it's scarcely relevant.
Very well, my lord. Mr. Kimmins, would you say that Reuben Hartley had had his fair share of the sort of problems you've just outlined to us?
Oh, yes, very much so. Although many of Reuben's problems have had to do with his kids. One of them having been killed in the most unnecessary type of way. Mm. Another being spastic. Even the younger ones have had their problems.
Yes, I see. What sort of a man is Mr. Hartley?
He's certainly not a violent one, even when goaded.
Has he ever expressed a grudge against Mr. Knox?
No. But he didn't have much cause to love him.
What, over the official site question?
Yes, there was no reason for anyone to be excluded.
Oh, but Mr. Knox claims that 6 caravans had to be excluded because of space.
Well, then he's a liar. Look, it was Knox who held a grudge against Hartley, not the other way around. Knox knew he couldn't just exclude one family. That really would stink of victimisation. So he cleverly wangled it that 6 would be excluded, which would look a damn sight more respectable.
Really, my lord, none of this was put to Mr. Knox in cross-examination.
Can you substantiate this, Mr. Kimmins?
Well, no. If I could, I'd have done something about it.
Well, if it's just your opinion, do not express it.
Oh, I see. I'm sorry.
Was there some question of Mr. Knox offering money to some of the travellers to leave Gander Common?
Well, before he knew the official site was going to be set up, Knox went round offering so much per caravan for the travellers to leave Gander Common. Obviously, he wasn't certain he was going to win over the official site, so he's trying to make certain by paying them off.
Did you witness all this, Mr. Kimmins?
Well, at first, Hartley told me about it. But then I hid in one of the trailers and overheard him talking.
When was this?
About 2 years ago.
Well, I mean, why didn't you do anything about it at the time?
Well, because I could only hear very indistinctly, and I wasn't sure what he was saying, so I didn't want to act until I had decisive evidence.
This grudge, do you have any substantiation for that?
Oh, yes. Well, Knox has a 19-year-old daughter called Christine. Hartley has an 18-year-old son named Charlie, and apparently they had an affair. I think Christine saw it as some kind of romantic trip. The travellers fascinated her. You know the rhyme, my mother said I never should
yes,
play
Yes, I do know the rhyme, Mr. Kimmins. Just come to the point.
But Charlie got her pregnant.
How do you know this?
Yeah, of course, she came and blurted out the whole story to me. Well, she was really very frightened. I advised her to tell her father immediately.
Carry on.
And did Mr. Knox know then that Charlie was the father?
Oh, Christine made no secret of it. Her father persuaded her to have an abortion. Well, it was probably the best thing to do. Yeah. But ever since then, of course, Knox has really had it in for Hartley.
My lord, this is all hearsay of the most objectionable kind.
Mr. Kimmins, did you ever have or overhear any conversation which led you to deduce that Mr. Knox believed that young Hartley had seduced his daughter?
Not myself, no.
Then let's hear no more of it. Now, carry on, Mr. Harvester, but do be careful. Try to keep your witness under control.
Very well, my lord. Mr. Kimmins...
Look, I have evidence to suggest that although Knox was knocked to the ground by Hartley, he was, in fact, kicked in the face, chest and stomach by Mr. Bruton.
That's ridiculous. Oh, really, this is going too far. That's just a liar.
My lord, I've never been involved in such a case where allegations are thrown around the room like confetti. And all hearsay are now this monstrous and absurd allegation against Mr. Bruton.
Mr. Harvester, can your witness substantiate this allegation?
Well, I had no idea that he was going to make it, my lord.
Now, Mr. Kimmins, perhaps you will be good enough to give us some hard facts.
Well, I have something here that spells out the situation.
Why was this not handed to the police or to Mr. Hartley's solicitor, if it is relevant?
Because I only received it last night.
Where from?
From Mr. Knox's daughter.
Yes, well, I think the jury had better retire now for a few moments. Kimmins.
The letter is incomplete, but the contents is as follows. Dear Ernie, as you refuse to speak to me on the telephone, I'm running the risk of typing this note. As Borough Surveyor, I've done you some good in the past, and I can do you some good again. But if you cut me out now, I'll shop you. Those gypsies must...
And the rest is missing.
Yes.
And you say that is from Mr. Bruton to Mr. Knox.
Yes. Mm.
Well, I think perhaps Miss Knox had better produce it, and until then the jury need not know of its contents, unless, of course, Mrs. Dixon, you wish to refer to it.
Thank you, my lord.
Bring the jury back.
So you expect us to believe that Mr. Knox's own daughter gave you incriminating evidence against him. Right, now, let's suppose for one moment, one lunatic moment, that we accept that your allegations are true. Do you really imagine that any man is going to leave such incriminating evidence just lying around? Oh, come on, now, surely even you must admit that that is absurd.
No, I admit nothing.
I see. Well, then, tell me what led you to suspect these two distinguished public servants, Mr. Kimmins?
Because I've been convinced for months that they both had a vested interest in Gander Common.
What, financial interest in the land?
Yes.
And that's why they wanted the squatters off?
Yes, as quickly as possible.
Ah, now, what sort of financial interest would this be, do you think?
Well, it's public knowledge that the motorway link would run straight past Gander Common.
Well?
Well, an oil company would pay a lot of money for a bit of that land.
Why, Mr. Kimmins? Do you think there's an oil well there?
No. An oil company would pay a lot of money to build a petrol station.
Oh, yes, I see. But from what you tell us, Mr. Bruton and Mr. Knox are not on the friendliest of terms.
Well, it's my opinion that Knox cut Bruton out at some stage.
And?
And now Bruton is blackmailing Knox.
Oh, yes, how very neat. And, of course, during the eviction, it was very convenient that Mr. Hartley knocked Mr. Knox to the ground, and then Hartley ran off, and there was nobody else around. The police were otherwise engaged. Oh, yes, it was all very convenient for Mr. Bruton to quickly and efficiently brutalize Mr. Knox and then fall to the ground himself with a wound over his right eye. Oh, by the way, how do you think he came by that? Do you think that was self-inflicted? Or did poor Mr. Knox have a chance to hit back?
Well, it could have been either.
These are simply your own beliefs, Mr. Kimmins. Now, I do hope that you understand the gravity of the allegations that you have just made. Now, Mr. Harvester, Mrs. Dixon, if either of you wish for Mr. Knox, Mr. Bruton, or the accused to be recalled, I shall gladly accede to that request.
Thank you, my lord.
Mr. Kimmins, in an attempt, and a very pathetic attempt, to shield your travelling protégés, you have trumped up slanderous charges, have you not, against two of the most respected men in Fulchester? Charges which are quite untrue.
I believe them to be true.
Well, your beliefs are not evidence.
Well, I think this would be a convenient moment to adjourn.
All stand.
The case of the Queen against Hartley will be concluded tomorrow in the Crown Court. Crown Court, Reuben Hartley, a Romany gypsy, is on trial accused of causing grievous bodily harm to a local councillor, Ernest Knox. Robert Kimmins, a social worker, yesterday claimed to have been handed a letter incriminating Knox and Derek Bruton, the borough surveyor. The final defence witness is in the box.
Miss Knox, how well do you know Mr. Kimmins?
Pretty well.
How well is that?
About 10 years.
Well, that's a long time. Why is that?
Well, he used to work for my father's youth project, Ravenscourt. Then Dad got him a job here.
Mr. Kimmins is an honest man, is he?
Yeah.
Good social worker.
Yeah. The travellers think he's terrific. He's done a lot of work for them.
Now, Mr. Kimmins is making serious allegations against your father, Miss Knox.
I know.
What's your reaction to this?
I'm sorry.
You're sorry?
For them both.
Speak up, Miss Knox.
For them both.
Could you expand a little?
No.
I want to ask you about something that happened 2 days ago. Now, were you at home 2 days ago?
Yes.
And did something happen?
No.
Well, did you notice anything?
Oh, yes, I found the letter. Yes.
Would you take a look at this, please? Is that the one that you found?
Yes.
It's a letter to your father?
Yes, from Mr. Bruton.
What did you do with it?
You mean, did I give it to Bob?
If you did, you must tell the court.
Yes, I gave it to him.
Where did you find it?
Screwed up, in the fireplace.
I see. And you gave it to...
To Mr. Kimmins that night.
Now, it was Mr. Kimmins that you first told about your expecting a baby, yes?
Yes.
What did he suggest?
That I saw my father.
And did you?
Yes.
Was he sympathetic?
No.
What was his attitude?
He was ashamed.
I see. What did he say to you?
He said I was a whore. He said he ought to kick me out of the house. He said I had to have an abortion.
Didn't you want one?
No.
Whose baby was it?
Charlie Hartley's.
And you wanted Charlie's baby?
Yes.
Did Charlie want to have it?
Yes, he came to our house with his father.
Did he meet your own father?
Yes.
What happened?
There was an awful row. My father told Mr. Hartley to get out.
Do you know anything of your father's financial situation?
Well, the business wasn't doing very well. But it must have been all right, because he said we wouldn't have to worry about money soon.
Really? When did he say that you wouldn't have to worry about money anymore?
A few months ago.
Did he say anything else?
Yes, he said that once he got the travellers off Gander Common, then our financial problems would be over.
Did you confide that to Mr. Kimmins?
Yes.
Then why was action taken so late?
Well, Bob, Mr. Kimmins, he couldn't bring himself to get my father into trouble. He admired him, you see.
Yes. Yes, I do see. Did your father know Mr. Bruton well?
They had a row.
When?
Last year, when the travellers were being kicked off.
What was it about?
I don't know.
One final question then, Miss Knox. Why did you so suddenly, and at such a late stage, give Mr. Kimmins that evidence that we've just seen in the letter?
Because I was determined that he wouldn't get away with it.
Thank you, Miss Knox.
Miss Knox, you've said that you were fond of Mr. Kimmins.
We were friends.
I see, yes. Were you in love with Charlie Hartley, the accused son?
He made me pregnant.
And your father suggested that you abort the child?
Suggested? He made me do it.
And because of your father's attitude and because of your relationship with the accused son and possibly your romantic attachment to the travellers in general, did you not conspire with your friend Mr. Kimmins to forge this very dubious letter?
No. No!
Finally, Miss Knox, you say that you found this letter screwed up in the fireplace. Now, would you just hold up the note for us? Now, apart from the unlikelihood of any such discovery, I must say, Miss Knox, I have never seen a less screwed up letter in my life. Have you? You didn't find this letter at all, did you? You or Mr. Kimmins forged it. Hmm? I have no further questions for this witness.
I remind you that you are still on oath, Mr. Bruton. Now, Mr. Bruton, you've been recalled because of certain allegations made by defense witnesses.
I see.
I'm very sorry that you have had to be recalled, but let us treat these allegations one by one.
I'd be glad to.
Now, were you at any point attacked by gypsy women during the course of the fracas?
No.
And this piece of cloth is no part of any trousers you possess?
Certainly not.
So, as you said, you were stunned and dazed and only came round when Inspector Macbeth arrived?
Yes.
Did you write this letter to Mr. Knox?
I have written to him from time to time.
It's very recent.
No. I definitely didn't write it.
Thank you.
Was Mr. Kimmins a great friend of the accused?
You could say they were very thick.
I see. Now, you know quite a lot about the travelling people, Mr. Bruton. Are you also a member of the support group?
I am.
And how did you join the support group?
Mr. Knox asked me to join.
Was Mr. Kimmins a member?
He was, but he resigned.
Oh, I see. But he still claims membership. Did he give any reason for his resignation?
No.
Now, this letter that has been produced, if, as you say, it was not written by you, then it must be an attempt at forgery.
Absolutely. This is simply another one of Kimmins' extraordinarily misguided stunts, except this time he's gone too far. Apart from the action that I expect the police to take, I shall consider taking legal action myself. No doubt he's already lost his job.
Thank you, Mr. Bruton. No more questions.
Yeah. Well, Mr. Bruton, you are very critical of Mr. Kimmins. Well,
I think I have good reason.
You make him out to be an irresponsible young fool.
That I consider him to be. Basically, I'm sure he's very well-meaning, but let's face it, he does have a tendency to get a bit carried away.
Isn't that true of all campaigners in their fight against social injustice?
That's a little melodramatic, isn't it?
In your opinion, then, he's just a fanatic.
Very much so.
Why do you think he is a fanatic?
Well, there are several prime examples, my lord. Let me give you a couple of them. Last year, Mr. Kimmins ran a campaign against a private hostel for unmarried mothers. His point was that unmarried mothers ought to be accepted naturally in society, and that a hostel was both discriminatory and shaming. A perfectly good point. Indeed, it's a point with which I myself fully agree. Unfortunately, Mr. Kimmins has a rather eccentric way of going about things. Instead of effectively campaigning, he sat on the roof of the hostel for 2 days with several insulting posters. I believe he was later sent a bill for damaged tiles.
I see. And the other occasion?
Oh, yeah, my lord, the other occasion was connected with the travelling people. Mr. Hartley said earlier that the police were unconcerned with vandalism and petrol bomb attacks on his community's caravans. I know that Chief Inspector Macbeth will corroborate that the police attitude was exactly the reverse, and that the site was regularly patrolled. However, this was not good enough for Mr. Kimmins. He organized a group of the gypsies into a vigilante patrol with himself as leader. Inevitably, this led the traveling people into a number of quite unnecessary clashes with the local people.
Yes, I see. Mr. Harvester?
Mr. Bruton, you still deny that that piece of cloth displayed earlier is from the seat of your trousers?
Yes, of course.
And you deny that the letter was written by you?
Yes.
Well, we've been over all this before, Mr. Harvester. I don't think we can take it any further, do you?
Well, perhaps not, my lord.
Mr. Knox, you do realize the extent to which Mr. Kimmins has implicated you?
I most certainly do. He's been very foolish, and I think his foolishness will cost him his job.
Yes, well, his foolishness, as you put it, could land you in the center of a police investigation.
I'm aware of that. I'm also aware, of course, of the fact that the Social Services Department could lose a damn good social worker.
Now, he says that he overheard you offering the travellers money to leave the common. Is that true?
Completely untrue.
Now, is there any reason why Mr. Kimmins should dislike you, harbour resentment against you?
Oh, I don't think so.
Be frank about this.
Well, I think we should remember, my lord, that I was first introduced, Mr. Kimmins, to the Social Services Department in Fulchester.
Yes, you got him the job.
Oh, no, he got it on his own merit.
I meant you introduced him to the job in the first place.
Yes.
How did that come about?
Well, he used to work for my youth project. He was a volunteer worker, and he was so good and so keen that I recommended him to have training and the rest, you know.
I do not, Mr. Knox. Now, is there anything else you know about him that the court should hear?
Well, there's one thing.
Well?
It happened before he joined the youth project. In his late teens, he served a short prison sentence for theft.
Did Mr. Kimmins have a close relationship with Mr. Hartley?
It was a social worker-client relationship.
Did Mr. Kimmins give any practical help to Mr. Hartley?
Oh, yes, I think he was helped enormously when Mr. Hartley's little girl was so tragically killed.
You yourself also offered to help Mr. Hartley's spastic daughter, is that so?
Well, I've tried. I've done what I could.
Yes. Well, thank you. Mrs. Dixon?
No questions, thank you, my lord.
Mr. Harvester?
Yes, my lord. Just tell me this, Mr. Knox. Did you at any stage receive this letter?
Yes, I did.
Mr. Knox, I suppose you realize that many excellent social workers have been vocational because of experience that they themselves have had in the past.
Well, I have no doubt of that.
Same could apply to Mr. Kimmins and his unfortunate experience, don't you think?
Well, that's very true. I have already stressed my highest admiration for Mr. Kimmins.
Yes. Mr. Knox, since Mr. Kimmins' evidence, my instructing solicitors have been checking records at Company's House. I see from these records that you and the chairman of Fulchester Town and Country Properties were both directors of a company called Progressive Building Limited.
That was true.
And you were a director of this company way back in 1958.
For a very brief period.
Oh, I wouldn't call 2 years a very brief period, would you?
Well, perhaps not. I was never a very active director of the syndicate. They persuaded me to join and I took little interest in it.
Such little interest that you put £25,000 into it?
Oh, my lord, these questions can have no conceivable relevance to the issues in this case.
I'm sure Mr. Knox does not object. Do you?
Not in the least, my lord.
Ah, then will you tell the court what this company was set up to do?
It's very simple. It's quite innocent. The company was originally created to invest in a private housing estate. Mm. It will be built on the town and country section of Gander Common. However, not enough money was raised. Planning permission was unattainable. Therefore, the project was dropped.
I see. Why did you tell your daughter, just a few months ago, that soon all your troubles would be over? You wouldn't have to worry about money anymore.
I'm afraid I didn't. She's never had to worry about money.
Really? This letter that you received from Mr. Bruton, you do realize, I suppose, that he completely denies sending it to you.
I can't think why. It's a perfectly straightforward letter. It describes my desperate attempts to get the remaining 6 caravans onto the site. Frankly, I was going to bend the law a little and put them in a field just above the site.
You never mentioned this before.
No, obviously not, but it's out now. Of course, Mr. Bruton is a more rigidly law-abiding citizen, was livid. And he risked writing me a very furious letter. Hmm. By cutting out, he refers to my going to law and bending the law a little. And shopping, well, I suppose he might have reported my actions to the chairman of the council. But at the last moment, Derek perjured himself on my behalf. He shouldn't have done that.
I suggest to you...
You can suggest what you like. I told you the truth.
Did not that note refer to Mr. Bruton's being cut out of a land deal involving this particular part of Gander Common? And wasn't he threatening you with physical violence because he was being cut out?
Utter nonsense!
Was it not, in fact, Bruton who hit you on the night of the 14th of November?
It was Hartley.
Well, yes, that's, of course, your version of this event. If you told the truth to the police, they would have had to have arrested Hartley. And then you would have become implicated, wouldn't you?
Rubbish! Derek Bruton is not the sort of person who would beat up a colleague. Whatever was at stake.
He is, however, quite capable of perjury, as we've seen. No further question.
And you are accusing Mr. Knox not only of corruption, but also of falsely accusing you of a crime which you claim was committed by Bruton. Now, why should he do that?
Because he ate his big guts. If he grassed up Bruton, Bruton would grass him up in turn.
Why didn't you claim that Mr. Knox had offered you money to leave Gander Common on the first time that you were examined?
Well, I didn't think of it, did I?
What, you mean you hadn't thought it up?
I'd forgot. Hmm.
Were you evicted in the same way from Rushy Green as you were from Gander Common?
Oh, no, they'd never have moved 200 trailers by force.
Well, how did they go about it?
Well, first of all, they cut off the water.
You mean you had piped water?
Oh, no, we had a few pipes and a few taps. Well, they cut them off. Then they told the dust not to collect, so we had piles of stinking rubbish. Then they dug a bloody great ditch round us so we couldn't get the mortars in or out.
They made it impossible for you to carry on your trade.
That's it, yeah.
Was Mr. Knox originally against your camping on Gander Common?
Oh, he pleaded with us not to. On his bleeding knees he was.
Did he give any reason?
Oh, he said it wasn't fit, you know, damp like kids would get ill.
Was it?
Well, it's no worse than rushy green. Some kids had rickets up there.
What else did he have against it?
We said it was surrounded by them council houses. He said the gauchos have a go at us.
Yes, and did they?
Oh, yeah.
How much money did Mr. Knox offer you to leave Gander Common?
Well, it started off at 50 quid a trailer. It went up to 100.
I'd like to ask you briefly about your relationship with Mr. Bruton.
Yeah. Well, he was Knoxy Boy's little stooge, wasn't he? I caught him measuring up the land one day.
Indeed, what was he doing that for?
Well, if I says I get a bollocking, won't I?
Well, what was his reaction when you challenged him?
Oh, right screwed up he was. Said it had something to do with road, but I knew better. He was measuring up for when they got us off, so him and Knoxy could collect.
And Mr. Kimmins, what do you think of him?
Bob? Hmm. Oh, he's a great bloke. You know, genuine like, you know. Well, he had a bit of trouble himself earlier on, so he understood us better like.
Well, better than who?
Well, Knoxy and Bruton. They had their own pockets to line.
Is Mr. Kimmins trustworthy, would you say?
Oh, he'd never tell you a lie, old Kimmins, never know.
Mr. Hartley, it was your son, Charlie, who was the father of Christine Knox's child.
Yeah, he ran away. He was chicken. He's a bad one, Charlie. We're best shot on him.
A last question then, Mr. Hartley. Do you still totally deny causing Ernest Knox grievous bodily harm?
I hit him once, and then I went after me girl, and that's God's truth, sir.
Thank you. Will you wait there?
Mr. Hartley, I suggest that because you bore a grudge against Mr. Knox and Mr. Bruton, you have allowed yourself to be manipulated by a devious and possibly hysterical man, namely Robert Kimmins.
I don't understand.
You don't understand? Mr. Knox has lost the sight in one eye. He has a punctured lung.
Well, I didn't do none of that.
Mr. Hartley, I put it to you that you never went to the aid of your daughter. She was safely in your caravan all the time. You didn't just hit Mr. Knox once. You knocked him to the ground.
No.
You stunned Mr. Bruton with a missile. You then kicked Mr. Knox savagely into unconsciousness, and then you ran towards your caravan.
That's bloody lies!
No, Mr. Hartley, that is the truth.
That bleeding copper! He couldn't see nothing. It was dark. There was no moon. Well, he
Chief
said
Inspector
so.
Inspector Macbeth is in no doubt that it was you who so savagely assaulted Mr. Knox.
But he couldn't see a bleeding thing.
Well, he did see you.
I never laid a finger on Knoxy.
Mr. Hartley, you have already admitted knocking Mr. Knox to the ground. Or are you now refusing to admit even this?
Look, I hit him once, but I never kicked him.
Thank you. I have no more questions.
You may leave the witness box, Mr. Hartley. Now, grievous bodily harm means really serious injury. And you may well think that Mr. Knox did suffer really serious injuries. He lost an eye and he suffered a punctured lung. But Hartley says that he only hit Knox once on the chin and that he was not responsible for those serious injuries. So it boils down to this. Hartley admits that he is guilty of assault. Common assault, we call it, but he's not guilty of the more serious crime of causing grievous bodily harm. So, the vital question is this: who did cause the serious injuries? Well, there are witnesses who say it was Hartley. Mr. Bruton says so, Mr. Knox says so, Inspector Macbeth says so. But the defense claims that they are lying. That Inspector Macbeth could not have seen what he claimed to have seen because it was too dark, and that it was Bruton who attacked Knox because they had disagreed over some property deal. Well, members of the jury, you have listened to the evidence, and it is for you to decide. Now, remember, you cannot return a verdict of guilty unless you are satisfied beyond reasonable doubt that Hartley was the person who caused these serious injuries to Knox. Now, would you please retire, elect a foreman, and consider your verdict.
All stand. Members of the jury, will your foreman please stand? Just answer this question yes or no. Have you reached a verdict upon which you are all agreed?
Yes.
Do you find the defendant, Reuben Hartley, guilty or not guilty of causing grievous bodily harm with intent?
Not guilty of causing grievous bodily harm with intent, but guilty of common assault.
Is that the verdict of you all?
It is.
You bastards!
Officer,
I'll be waiting for you, Nazi! All you are!